Hi, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Bobcat Football. Today we come to you from the campus of Ohio University and Peen Stadium. The Cats will host the Eastern Michigan Hurons today. The Cats coming in with a 3-1 Mid-American Conference record, while the Hurons are 3-2. My name is John Lyons, along with Mark Lowry. And Mark, who would have thought that it would be such a critical game for both clubs?
Well, coming into the season, a lot of people had high hopes for Eastern Michigan, of course, being the MAC defending champions and the California Bowl champions, and they've played pretty well throughout the year. Whereas for Ohio, nobody had really great expectations of them coming into the year. They started the season with three straight losses, but they've rebounded. They've turned things around. They've won three of their last four, and right now they're tied for first place in the Mid-America Conference, and all the teams that they're tied with for first place, they still have to play yet this season.
Yeah, you see both clubs coming onto the field right now. Mark, let's talk offense here for a second. The Hurons lost Gary Patton to graduation, but they don't lose much. They're in the capable hands of Bob Foster, and for OU, there's Andrew Greer.
Well, Bob Foster really has picked up the slack that was left by graduation. He just went over the 1,000-yard career rushing mark, and he's averaging over 4.5 yards per carry, while Andrew Greer is fifth in rushing in the Mid-American Conference, and he's second in all-purpose yardage. He's really taken over the void that was left by John Caldwell, and along with Anthony Thornton, they're the leaders of Ohio offense.
And defensively, neither club ranked that high in the Mid-American Conference, but they played some good ball games.
Well, Eastern is fifth in the conference and Ohio seventh overall. But one thing you got to look at is both of these teams only lose two guys to graduation at the end of this season. They'll have 9 returning starters next year, and the future's got to look bright for both of them. While Coach Cleve Bryant was mentioned earlier in the week that maybe the reason his Bobcat defense has been playing so well as of late is that maybe they don't know what's going on. They're too young really to realize all the pressures of being in first place.
And there you see the balloons being released. Mark, any explanation for the balloons?
Well, that's the up and away drive that all the money that was donated this week that were generated through the fraternities and sororities here at OU, along with the Chimes Honorary, they raised like $2,500 for the Arthritis Foundation. And what they do is they attach some letters to some of the balloons, and whichever letters retrieve from the furthest distance, that fraternity or sorority, or even if it's Chimes, will get like a free Pepsi machine for the house for the rest of the year.
And it would appear this game may be slightly delayed as they're now trying to clean up the balloons that didn't get such a good start off the field. Let's set up the officials for today's game. The referee is David Witvoet. James Stodd is the umpire. The linesman is Norman Eubank. The line judge is William Klenoschek. Philip Barnes is your field judge. The back judge is Don Edwards. And those will be the officials for today's contest. Both teams starting to come on the field now. Of course, Mark mentioned Cleve Bryant. Cleve, the coach of Ohio University, comes in today 7-33 career here at OU. He is in his fourth season. Jim Harkema, last year's coach of the year for 1987 at 27-33-2 at EMU.
Well, there was a lot of criticism about Cleve Bryant over the last couple years and even at the beginning of this season, but he told everybody to be patient. It's a very young football team and they just hadn't gelled yet. A good case is last year with Bruce Porter. The fans wanted to see Porter in there throwing the ball. Instead, Bryant elected to stay with Anthony Thornton, and that move has really paid off. Right now, Ohio seems to be lining up. It's the same onside kick formation they used at the beginning of the game to Miami, which they did recover the ball and start their drive right away at the beginning of the game. Kind of surprised the Redskins. This is the exact same formation they used just 3 weeks ago.
Exactly. Jim Delverne, the freshman, to kick off, and they are in the onside formation. And now it looks like they'll break out to a regular kickoff. I'm not sure if Cleve just wants to have the troops for the Hurons thinking about it or if they're going to go for it for real. And here comes the kickoff. It is regular. Not a very good one, though. Up in the air, caught by number 19. That's Matt Swank, who catches the short kickoff. And the Bobcats take him down at the 23-yard line. So that's where Eastern will set it up. They'll have the ball. The Bobcats go on to defense. So Cleve Bryant showing the possible onside, but then kicking it away. Not a great kick, but nevertheless, they get him at the 23-yard line.
They've had problems doing that all year. The balls haven't been kicked that deeply on the kickoffs, which results in short returns, but I guess it averages out here as Eastern will start at about the 28-yard line.
Yeah, pardon me, it is the 28-yard line. Tom Sullivan leads the troops out. In the backfield is Nash and Foster. The give is to Foster. He's over the left side. Good for 2 yards up to the 30, That'll bring down, bring up second down and eight. Jack Leader with a tackle for Ohio University.
Well, Coach Bryant said he wanted Eastern to throw the ball more than run, and that they were going to key on Foster all game. And that's a good start for the Bobcats, only giving up 1 yard on first down. Because when they do have the long third and second down situations, they're going to have to throw the ball as the game wears on.
Second and eight, maybe nine. The quick hitter to Nash up the middle. He gets 3, maybe 4 yards. Nehemiah Hare is in on the tackle. Hare had a fantastic game last week, Mark.
Well, we didn't think Hare would get the start. We thought Antonio Young would be back for this week's game. But Hare had 19 tackles last week, along with an interception and 2 fumble recoveries. And that was his first college start.
Okay, the ball sitting on the 39-yard line, 3rd and 4 for the Hurons.
Third down, 4.
The wideouts are Ostrander and Ziegler. Sullivan back to pass. He looks for Ziegler. He's got him at the 50-yard line, down to the Ohio 45 and knocked out of bounds at the 42-yard line. Ziegler ran a little out pattern to the left side of the field, wide open, and Sullivan hit him with a strike.
Well, it was a zone defense there by Ohio. Todd Sims, the linebacker, out there on the coverage. Ziegler was able to get behind him and in front of Devlin Culliver, and it was plenty of yardage for the first down, and that's not the kind of play Cleve Bryant wants to see on a 3rd and 4, a long completion down the field like that.
The ball just shy of the 40. Only one wideout. It is Ostrander out to the right side. They give us to Foster. He's over the left side for a gain of 2, perhaps 3 yards. Bringing up 2nd down and 7, the tackle by Bill Garrett for Ohio University. And what a season Bill Garrett is having.
Well, Garrett was the MAC Player of the Week a couple of weeks ago following his game against Toledo, and he's a team leader on this defense.
He comes in with 90 tackles, 52 solo. So he's been in on a lot of plays for the Bobcats. We have a strong right side. Nine Heist is in for Eastern Michigan, along with Ziegler out to the right. The give again to Foster. Foster moving left, he's got some room. He breaks a big gainer, finally brought down by number 47, Nehemiah Hare, and number 5, Sean Perter. He gets down to the Ohio 26-yard line, another first down for the Hurons.
Nice little misdirection play there, Foster. They had a nice fake up the middle and looked like everybody was going to the right, but they brought a lineman back to the left and opened up a nice hole on the left side, which is plenty of yardage to pick up the first down.
Nash and Foster in the I formation. The give is the quick hitter to Nash. He's up the middle. Picks up about another 5 yards. He's down to the Ohio 20-yard line. So Eastern really mixing it up, Mark. They came in, you said they were balanced, and they're showing it here. A couple of quick hitters to the fullback Nash, giving it to their tailback Foster, and even throwing the football when they need to. So 2nd down and 4 yards to go. The ball will call at the 20. It's in between the 20 and the 21-yard line of OU. Nine Heiss and Ostrander out of the wideouts. Sullivan again gives to Foster. Evangelista can't bring him down, but some other Bobcats do. David Terry was in there, and they drop him for a loss of about a yard.
David Terry having a splendid season for the Bobcats. Of course, he's a junior college transfer and a former Marine out there playing.
Let me set real quick for you the Eastern Michigan front line. It's Matt Colasa, or Mike Rowe, rather. Jim Colosimo is the center. Mark McHugh is up front, also along with Steve Brocklebank. They were the starting front for Eastern. We'll get to the defense for the Bobcats in just a second as the Hurons are driving. Drop for that loss, 3rd and 5. Ball on the 21. Back to pass to Sullivan. He's looking deep. He's got his man open. Caught and out of bounds at the 1 yard line is Mark Ziegler.
Ziegler wants a touchdown on that. His left foot did scrape the flag in the front end of the end zone. The referee's not going to give it to him. You can see the flag moving on the play. But instead, it'll be first down for Eastern Michigan at the Ohio 1.5 yard line.
Sure, it was awfully close. Mark Ziegler wide open again. He did an out pattern this time to the right side. Really the same play as we saw before. It's a first down and goal to go for the Hurons on the 1/2 yard line. In the wishbone, Nash tries to get in. I don't know if he made it. It looks like he may have been stopped just shy of the goal line. There's been no touchdown indication as of yet, so it will bring up 2nd and goal for the Hurons.
Good penetration there by the Ohio defense. Nash, a stocky fullback at 5'9", 230. He was the only first-year freshman to play for the Hurons last season, now a sophomore. and he's the fourth leading scorer on Eastern Michigan. Foster, of course, is the leading scorer with 6 touchdowns this year.
And Mitch Brown has checked in for the Hurons, setting the wishbone formation in the backfield. Second and goal to go. The give is to Foster. Touchdown! We have a late indication it is a touchdown. Eastern Michigan, and they take an early 6-0 lead.
Bobcats didn't like that. They stopped the forward progress. It was a second effort there by Foster that finally did get him into the end zone. There's a little pushing and shoving after the play. The Bobcats thought that they had forced a third down situation for Eastern Michigan, but instead the referee signaled a touchdown, and Eastern takes a 6-0 lead with 10:57 remaining in the first quarter.
Well, yeah, I couldn't say anything. It was close. The referees paused and then give the touchdown indication. Credit Bob Foster with a 1-yard TD run. Tom Hennigan trying to add on the extra point for the Hurons. The kick is up, and it is good. So with 10:57 left to go here in the first quarter, the Hurons lead this contest by a score of 7-0.
Very balanced attack there for Eastern Michigan. They mixed the ball, like you said, up well. They had the nice pass on the third down and long, or third and four at the 50. They came back and ran the ball. They had the long pass down to the corner of the end zone. They were mixing up very well, trying to keep Ohio off guard. We mentioned in the opening that they are a very balanced attack team, and they showed it on that drive, John.
They certainly did. They put together a beautiful drive.
72 yards, 10 plays, 4 minutes.
That drive took up 4 minutes and 2 seconds, going 72 yards, rather, and 13 plays. The 1-yard TD run by Foster. And that is his 7th touchdown of the season. So the Bobcats trail it early by a score of 7-0. Andrew Greer back for the Bobcats as the Hurons are set to kick off. He is number one in kickoff returns with an average of 24.8 yards a return. And the Hurons showing a funny formation here on the kickoff. Who knows what they may do? I believe they'll probably branch out and kick it long.
John Lopp to
kick it deep. Hennigan is the short kicker for the Hurons. Loud kicks off and handles the long field goal duties, so he'll boot this one away for Eastern.
There's a fake onside kick there. Maybe they're mocking the Bobcats a little bit, making fun of the Bobcats formation before they spread out to kick it away.
Loud nails it, not too deep. No, it'll be Larry Hargrove takes it at his own 14-yard line. Takes it out to about the 23, maybe the 24, and the Bobcats will set up shop right there. Larry Hargrove took that one away from Andrew Greer. He said, I'll take it, Andrew, and he carries it up to his own 23.
Well, this game does have a little different of a start than last year's Eastern Michigan 34-16 win over Ohio. Last year, Ohio scored first on a Mike Fultz field goal, but then it was 21 straight points for Eastern Michigan to really extend their lead, but Ohio came back in the fourth quarter. They gave up 13 points in the fourth quarter, and Eastern went on to win 34-16.
And there was an offsides penalty on the kicking team there, and Coach Bryan is going to have Eastern do it all over again, I believe. So the referee will march it back 5, and Mr. Loud will get another chance. Let's set the OU offense when they come out on the field. Anthony Thornton is your quarterback. Dana Griffin will get the start at fullback with Andrew Greer back there at the tailback spot. The front line looks like this. J.D. Bradbury, Miles Davidson, Brian Fout is the center. Dean Nance, the left guard. The left tackle is Don Schimmick. Byron Cross and Bobby Cameron will be your wideouts. Jerry Leibold is the tight end.
Same formation as they had last time on the kickoff.
Yeah, they'll probably spread it out and go deep again. We'll get to that Huron defense in just a minute as we await the kickoff. Well, Loud taking his time on this one, marches up to the ball. Now backs up. I believe he will send it deep.
Wouldn't be surprised if they try to kick it away from Greer once again.
Probably a smart move. As we said, he does lead the Mid-American Conference. This one a little bit better kick. But Hargrove will take it in about the same place, the 15-yard line. He's up over the 25 to the 30 and out to the 35-yard line. A good return by Larry Hargrove and a good move by Coach Bryant.
Well, that mistake on the offsides for Eastern Michigan on the kickoff cost him 13 yards as the Bobcats will set up offense at the 34-yard line rather than the 21.
And to set the Eastern defense, Donshell English, Mike Bass, Herman Bain, and Brad Schmidt will be up front. A fine linebacking core consisting of Scott Jurek, Scott Wyka and Dean Nesson. We'll get to the cornerbacks in just a second. The Bobcats in the wishbone formation now. The give is to Dana Griffin. He's out over the 40 to the 45 and up to the 47-yard line. So the Bobcats come out in the wishbone, and Dana Griffin takes the first carry of the game for the Bobcats, a first down.
No surprises there on the first call of the game. Eastern Michigan all week had to be stressing in practice that they got to stop the Ohio rushing attack. Ohio is 8th out of 9 teams in passing offense, and they're 4th in rushing offense. So it's obvious that they're going to be running Andrew Greer and Dana Griffin throughout the game. And that's a great sign for Ohio fans as he picks up 12 yards on the first play from scrimmage.
Daryl Legere is in the game completing the wishbone formation. Kyle Feldman is the wideout to the bottom of your screen. The give is again to Griffin. He gets a yard, maybe. Brought down by a host of Hurons. Mike Bass led the way for Eastern. Let's set the rest of that defense for you. We went over the line and the linebackers. The quarterbacks are Dan Bennett and Charles Gordon. Tom Menard is the free safety. And John Stoitziadis is what they call the rover. Who knows where he'll be out there, kind of roaming around. He has a big role to play. Right now he's at a safety position. He plays a big role on this Huron defense. His name will come up a lot this afternoon. A fumble of the snap. Thornton picks it up. Pitches to Greer. He's got nowhere to go. He does get outside, though, for a little bit of room. Finally dragged out of bounds at about the 48-yard line by number 6, Tom Menard.
Well, that's a good way to make nothing out of very little. The Bobcats looked like they were going to have a big loss on the play, but it was a nice move by Greer to get around Nesson to at least get back to the original line of scrimmage. And it'll be third down and long for Ohio. It's not a situation Ohio offense likes to be in. Third and nine, not being a passing team, they'd rather be in the third and four, third and three range, as any offense would.
Exactly, and I'm glad you touched on that. It's important to bring up. The bread and butter of Ohio is the run, and as you say, Mark, they'd rather not throw, if at all, only when they have to, probably. It's third and nine. This would be a passing situation, but you never know what the Bobcats probably will stick to the run. No, Thornton rolling out. Looks like he wants to throw, fires over the head of Ollie Perkins, incomplete, and the Bobcat punting unit will come onto the field. So the first drive really goes nowhere. A quick first down pickup by Dana Griffin, but from there on out, it's really nothing, all for naught for the Bobcats. Andy Grombacher to do the punting. Grombacher is 5th in punting in the Mid-American Conference. Ziegler and Charles Gordon back deep. This is Gordon. He takes it at his own 20, moves up to the 25, and he's knocked down there by almost the entire Bobcats special team unit. Good coverage by the Bobcats. The tackle was led by number 37, John Parker.
Gordon, of course, last year's Mid-American Conference punt return leader at the end of the year, led the conference in punt returns. He was an all-conference defensive back. And that time, he didn't have much room to operate as he only had a 4-yard return. And Eastern will set up shop at the 26-yard line with 9:28 remaining in the first quarter, leading 7-0.
Again, it's Nash and Foster in the backfield. Strong side right with the wideouts. The give is to Foster. He's over the right side. Picks up about 4, maybe 5 yards. We'll call it second down and 5 for the Hurons. Let me set the Bobcat defense. I failed to do that on the first drive of the game. Jack Leader, Mike Rechtenwalt, and John Evangelista are up front for the Cats. The linebackers, and it's quite a linebacking core at that, are Derek Kendricks, Bill Garrett, David Terry, and Ed Shy. And we're ready to go. I'll get to the rest of that in just a second. Eastern coming out quick out of the huddle. The quick hitter to Nash. He's up the middle for another couple of yards. Probably close to first down yardage. However, it will be third down. Third, and we'll call it 1 yard to go. The ball resting on the 35-yard line.
Third down, one.
Let me complete that defense. Larry Hargrove is one corner. Devlin Culliver the other. Antonio Young scheduled to get the start, but Nehemiah Hare with the great game last week is in at the free safety position. Tim Pringle is the strong safety. The wishbone formation as brother Perry Foster has come in to join Bob, completing the wishbone. They give us to Nash looking for the first down. I don't know. I don't think he got it, Mark.
No second effort there. He was just laid down by David Terry.
Terry comes into this game with 99 tackles, 65 of those solo, and they are going to call it a first down. So I don't know. Close. They won't even measure it, though. The officials say first down. And 10 to go with the ball on the 36-yard line. 8:11 to go in the first. Ziegler is out to the right side for the Hurons. Play action fake. Rolling is Sullivan. He looks over the middle, fires. The ball tipped up and picked off. Larry Hargrove comes up with the interception for Ohio. The ball came off Mark Ziegler's hands, went into the air, and Larry Hargrove comes down with it at the 45-yard line of Ohio.
Credit the pressure by the Ohio defense for that interception. Sullivan was hit as he threw the ball, which kind of floated up in the air. And did Bill Garrett lay a punch to Mark McHugh laying on the ground down there? The officials didn't see it, but McHugh, of course, didn't like it and got back up into Garrett's face. But nevertheless, it's the Bobcats first and 10. We have half this first quarter remaining.
And Larry Hargrove comes up with interception number 3 on the season with 7:55 remaining here in the first quarter of play. The Bobcats back out on offense, the wishbone formation, Lejeune, Griffin, and Greer. Thornton fakes to Griffin, takes it around the left end for 5, maybe 6, maybe even 7 yards, depending on the spot. Thornton loves to do that. He's a heck of a runner. He comes into this third in the MAC in total offense with 304 yards rushing, I believe.
We mentioned Andrew Greer's running and all-purpose yardage, but he threw a nice block out there leading the way on the option on Charles Smith, who's an all-conference performer. So Greer trying to help out as any way he can, trying to spring Thornton free around the left end.
He did get 7 yards, 2nd and 3 to go for the Bobcats. Thornton gives to Griffin this time up the middle. Got maybe 2. We'll call it a yard. That'll bring up 3rd and 2 for the Cats.
This is exactly what Ohio wants to do. They don't want a 3rd and 8, 3rd and 9 like they had with the miscue on the fumbled snap in the last drive. When you get into the situations where you have 3rd and 2, 3rd and 3 in this area here, you can do just about anything you want. And when you're a rushing offense, you know, you got to go to your bread and butter here and just try to pick up the first down and sustain the drive.
The Hurons expecting the run as they come with a 5-man front. The give is to Greer. He's got the first down and a little more. He works his way down to the Eastern Michigan 41-yard line. First down, Ohio.
First down, Bobcat.
Dean Nance managed to bring him down, but not before. Excuse me, Dean Nance is placed for Ohio. Obviously, he didn't bring him down. He threw the block. Dean Nance opening the big hole for Andrew Greer. The ball down on the 41 now, 1st and 10, Ohio. Some movement on the line by the Hurons. Nothing called though. Thornton going left. Picks up another couple of yards, maybe 3. Anthony Thornton, as I said, has rushed for 304 yards, an average of 3.8 a carry, so he's very capable. Brought down by Scott Wyka. Wyka leads this team in tackles with 64, and he's a heck of a linebacker, Mark.
2nd down, 5.
He's also a wrestler in high school. We'll get to that a little bit later. An interesting story about him and the Huron wrestling team.
Yeah, Scott Wyka, one heck of an athlete. He makes a stop there on Thornton. 2nd and 5 to go for Ohio. Thornton fakes the give to Griffin. A quick throw. Oh, my. I believe the pass was intended for Kyle Feldman.
Thornton's pass. And incomplete.
Feldman knocked on his can, if you will, by John Stoitziadis. He was not looking for the ball. Thornton with a little timing pattern there. He faked the handoff to Griffin and threw it. Stoitziadis took Feldman right out of the play as the ball passed him by.
I don't know if Feldman was thinking maybe he was going to get the ball further downfield, but he was open. Thornton had a good pass, and if he was looking, that might have taken some cushion off that blow, but he wasn't expecting anything.
No, he got popped, and it's 3rd and 5 now for Ohio. The give is to Greer. He's got room on the left side, works his way over the first down marker, 1st down, Ohio. He's down to the 29-yard line of Eastern Michigan. I'll tell you, Andrew Greer saw the first down marker and went right for it. He gets the first down.
That's a mark of a good running back. It looked like the play was designed to go to the right. Greer didn't see an opening, decided to cut it back to the left side where he saw some daylight and was able to pick up the first down as Ohio continues to drive now inside the 30-yard line of Eastern Michigan.
And we talked about the bread and butter being the run, and they stick with it on 3rd and 5. It produces good results. Thornton fakes the give to Griffin, moving to the right side, picks up a couple, down to the 25, maybe the 24-yard line of Eastern Michigan. Again, Scott Wyka on the tackle for the Hurons. He'll bring up 2nd down and 5 yards to go. I'll tell you, the Bobcats putting together a nicely sustained drive here, whittling their way into Eastern Michigan territory. Bobby Cameron is back into the game. He's wide out to the right at the bottom of your screen. Thornton looking to pass, fakes now, up the middle. He may have gotten the first down. He's down to the 18-yard line.
I like the fake there by Thornton. What they're doing so far is they're trying to extend this Eastern defense. Eastern was able to do it to Ohio on the first drive by mixing the run and the pass, and the more the field you make the defense cover, the better off you're going to be. Here Ohio's run to the outside to the right. We had Greer going back to the left. There's the pass to the left that was intended for Feldman. This time they have the fake pass over the middle. He runs up the middle, and if the defense doesn't know or can't expect where the ball is going to be, it makes it that much harder for them to cover the field.
Exactly, Mark. It is a first down. They took time out for a measurement. The ball actually spotted on the 19-yard line, but good enough for a first down. It looks like Cleve Bryant utilizing the sprint option offense he talked about earlier in the week, Anthony Thornton possibly using the pump fake and then taking it up the middle, and he did just that for the first down. Kyle Feldman is the wideout. You saw him there at the bottom of your screen. Still the wishbone formation for the Bobcats. The give is to Griffin. He fumbles, and I believe Eastern Michigan has recovered. Not a great handoff. He kind of put it in Griffin's hip, and Griffin had all kinds of trouble, never did get control. He drops it, and it is recovered by the Hurons at their own 15-yard line. Not a good break for the Bobcats.
Well, that's the Bobcats' 29th fumble so far in the year, and that's the 15th they've lost. It's not a good statistic. It kills drive. They had problems in the beginning of the season. They kept crediting all the miscues and turnovers for the losses, and they haven't really been doing that over the last four games. But here it stalls the drive, and Eastern takes back over.
A critical error for the Bobcats. Eastern back out on offense. It's Nash and Perry Foster in the backfield. This is Perry Foster moving out over the 15-yard line, up to the 18. Good for a gain of about 3 yards, bringing up second down and 7 yards. We mentioned before Foster, the Foster brothers, rather, Bob and Perry, they are brothers. Perry, just a freshman, a 6-foot, 190-pounder, and he's having a good season, 339 yards on the season, 4 yards a carry, so he'll see a lot of action back there as he fills in for his brother from time to time. Nienhuyzen, Ostrander are the wideouts, strong side right. The give again to Perry Foster. He moves out over the 20, and he may have fumbled. I have a feeling the ground caused that one, though, Mark. The ball did come loose, but they're going to say the ground caused the fumble. He'll be down at the 20-yard line.
David Terry there with the tackle, stopping him well short of the first down. But as you said, the ball squirted out after he hit the ground.
Well short of the first down indeed. It is third down and 5 to go. The Hurons actually on their own 21-yard line now. Mark Ziegler is back into the game. He comes in motion to the left side. The Hurons in the wishbone formation as both Fosters are now into the game. And the Hurons look awfully confused. In fact, I believe they're going to take a timeout.
Well, the time clock to get the snap off was down to 2 seconds. And in college, you only get 25 seconds now. In pro football, they've upped it to 45 to try to speed up the pace of the game. Most due to television timeouts and all that, the pro games just are extended too long. They moved it to 45 to try to speed up the play. Here in college, it's 25-second clock, and it was down to 2. So rather than take the 5-yard loss and move them back to the 16-yard line, they take their first time out of the game, and then they remain in a 3rd and 4, 3rd and 5 situation.
And Mark, you mentioned something a second ago, and I think it's important. We don't want to beat it to death, but certainly something to touch on. Turnovers have just plagued the Bobcats, especially early on. You said that lately they haven't been doing it as much, and thus they've come up with some victories. But early in the season, fumbles all over the place, really. What more can you say? And it just kills a drive. The offense moves the ball, but then they lose it.
Well, they, like we said, that was their 29th fumble of the year, and they've only forced 16. So there's a difference of 13 forced fumbles there, which makes a big difference throughout the course of the season.
Okay, we're back to action. Sullivan gives to, I believe it's Perry Foster. No, it's Bob Foster. Either Foster, no matter which it may be, he has the first down. It is definitely Bob Foster. He has the first as he moves out to the 29-yard line. Just 2:38 remaining now here in the first quarter. The Hurons lead this one by a score of 7-0. John Lyons along with Mark Lowry here at Peden Stadium on the campus of OU. First down for the Hurons. They have the ball on their own 29-yard line. Nienhuis in motion. The give is to Charles Nash. He's up the middle, some room, he gets outside. He doesn't have the speed to go all the way, but he certainly had the room to do it. He gets outside and works his way all the way down to the Bobcat 44-yard line.
Put a nice move on the inside, and he got a nice lead block out in front of him by Craig Ostrander.
Ostrander, the wide receiver, did throw him a beauty, and as we said, Nash didn't quite have the speed to go all the way, but he certainly had plenty of room down that left side as he made a nice cutback. So first down and 10 to go, the ball on the Bobcat 44-yard line. The pitch is to Foster, Bob Foster. He's got room, he may go all the way. He splits the middle of the Bobcat defense. Touchdown, Eastern Michigan. And Mark, what can you say? They set the wishbone formation, pitch it to Foster. He simply takes it up the middle and all the way for a 44-yard touchdown run.
We talked about the blocking of Andrew Greer on the last drive. That time, Charles Nash threw a heck of a block on David Terry, which sprung him open and was wide open hole there for Foster. Went untouched all the way down for the touchdown. Now Foster, with 42 total points on the season, leads us here on team in scoring.
He picks up touchdown number 7, and Tim Hennigan will try to make it 14-0 Hurons. The kick is up, and it is good. So with 2:06 left to go in the first quarter of play, it's Eastern Michigan 14, Ohio nothing.
I think the problem with the Bobcats so far is consistency. On offense, they have sparks. They look like they're going to start a drive, but then they've had the miscues. The first drive, they had the nice run by Dana Griffin to start it. There was the fumbled snap, which resulted in a long third down, and they were forced to punt. Last time they had the long drive, they were already down inside the 20-yard line, and they had another fumble, and Eastern Michigan's taken advantage of these miscues by the Bobcats. Defensively, the Bobcats show spurts of being showing a good effort. They've stopped them in a couple plays, but then it's the big play that kills them. It was the pass down to the goal line on the first scoring drive, and then that long run there, when it looked like the Bobcats were just regathering. Now it's a 14-point lead. And it could be tough for a running team to get back into a game, even though we do have 2:06 remaining in the first quarter. The Bobcats are going to have to settle down and get back in this game bit by bit.
And John Loud to put it away for the Hurons. Again, they set up that strange formation. That drive for the Hurons went 85 yards in just 5 plays, only took up about 2 minutes on the clock. Credit Bob Foster with a 44-yard touchdown run. Again, it's Greer back deep for the Cats. They'll probably try and keep it away from him, though. No, Greer will field it at his own 10, up to the 15, the 20, out over the 25, the 30. He's got some room over to the 35 and finally brought down at the 40-yard line. So Andrew Greer leading the back in kickoff returns, and that's why he's finally brought down by Paul Denson, but not before he turns in a beauty, a 30-yard return out to his own 40. And here's an interesting stat, Mark.
Well, Eastern Michigan is 4-for-4 on third down conversions. The Bobcats have been able to pin them and make them force the third down situations, but they haven't been able to stop them on third down. They've completed every one. They have 121 yards on the ground already, and that's not what Ohio wanted to see.
The Bobcats in the wishbone formation, 2 minutes to go in the first. Thornton tried to fake the give to Dana Griffin, but he had no time to fake or do anything as he's crushed by the entire front of the Eastern Michigan defense and dropped for a loss. We'll call it second down and 12. Thornton dropped for a loss of 2 on the play. Daryl Lejeune and Bobby Cameron leave the ball game as Kyle Feldman checks in. The Bobcats go with the I formation now. It is Dana Griffin and Andrew Greer. Thornton looking to throw, rolling to his left. He's got the tight end, Jerry Liebold. Jerry makes the catch at the 45-yard line, and he's knocked out of bounds.
Nice catch there by Jerry Liebold. He did step out of bounds at the 45-yard line, so it'll be 3rd and 5 for the Bobcats. It looked like he moved his way up close to the 50, where it would have been 3rd and 1. But he, as we said, he stepped out of bounds on the far sideline. It'll be 3rd and 5 Ohio, 1:17 remaining in the first quarter.
So Anthony Thornton utilizing his tight end. He now has Ollie Perkins and Kyle Feldman on the strong right side. He gives to Andrew Greer. Greer trying to get outside. He doesn't have much room. The defense strings it out.
Andrew Greer on the carry.
Dan Bennett finally brings Greer down as they string it out well, but it's good for the first down.
It wasn't a crushing block out there by Kyle Feldman, but he got the job done. All he did is try to keep Bennett away for as long as possible, and Greer was able to move his way up into Huron territory for the first down.
A good job by Greer, like we said. Eastern Michigan really stringing out the defense, but Greer picked his way for the first down.
A lot of times you don't need big blocks by your wide receivers. You just need them to keep the defense away for as long as possible. They don't need long driving blocks like you want on the line.
The backs are now split behind Anthony Thornton. Thornton looking to throw again. He lost it deep. He's got Ollie Perkins open, or excuse me, that is Byron Cross, and he overthrew him, throwing out of bounds. That was Byron Cross open down the left sideline, but Thornton overthrows him. Thornton came into this game 51 for 116. That is good for a 44% completion ratio. 9 interceptions, and he has thrown for 3 touchdowns. He is ranked 11th in passing efficiency in the MAC, but as we said, the Bobcats don't throw all that often. They like to stick to the run, and they're back to the wishbone formation. Thornton fakes the Griffin. He's got some room. He gets outside to the right, makes a cut, and he's down to the Eastern Michigan 27-yard line. A real beauty by Anthony Thornton. Faked the give to Dana Griffin and took it himself for a first down.
The key to that play, which opens that up, is the fake itself. Brad Schmidt, the defensive end for Eastern Michigan, totally bit on the fake and tackled Dana Griffin. I myself thought the ball was given up the middle, and it opened up a huge lane for Thornton down the right side, and some nifty running gives him the first down, down to the 27-yard line.
And Chris Mobley has checked into the ball game for the Bobcats. He completes the wishbone in the backfield. Thornton gives to Mobley. Mobley with a nice power run down to about the 20-yard line. Good to see Chris Mobley getting some action.
Mobley, of course, a senior out of Lakewood St. Edward High School outside of the Cleveland area, where he's an all-state performer. And his offensive line in high school, I think, might have been the biggest offensive line I've ever seen in high school football. When you complement that with a good runner, you know, that's what gets your all-state performers.
We have come to the end of the first quarter here at Peden Stadium. The score, Eastern Michigan 14, Ohio nothing. We're going to take a break, and we'll come right back with the second quarter. You're watching AVW Sports on ACTV Cable Channel 7.
Hi, I'm Andy Stocky. It's all for real now. The 1988 Mid-American Conference football season is well underway. For the first down to the last word on Bobcat football, be sure to join head coach Cleve Bryant and myself for the Cleve Bryant Show. All the stats, all the scores, this week's action, and a whole lot more. The Cleve Bryant Show, Friday nights at 7 on the home of Ohio University Bobcat Sports, ACTV Cable, Channel 7.
Stadium. It is second down and 9 to go for the Cats. The ball on the 44. The pitch is to Chris Mobley. He works his way around the left side to the 50-yard line. John Lyons along with Mark Lowry. We have begun the fourth quarter of play here. The Bobcats came in today atop the Mid-American Conference in a four-way tie with a 3-1 record. But Mark, if they want to hold on to that first place spot. They better do a little bit better than they're doing now as they trail 17-7.
Well, the Bobcats hold their own destiny. If they win the rest of their games, they'll go to the California Bowl and win the conference. If they should lose here today, the way they could still win the conference is to win their next three games against Western, Central, and Ball State, but they would also need an Eastern Michigan loss.
And they have an important third and one situation here. Working from the I formation, Thornton pitches to Greer. I don't think he got the first down. He's dropped at the 49. I almost said the 51. Yeah, that's right. There are two halves of the football.
This isn't Canada, Jack.
Yeah, I'm thinking a little CHL, a little Canadian football. But well, that's hockey, isn't it? Whatever.
CFA, Jack.
Oh, I'll tell you.
CFL.
Well, let me get my head back on now. It is a fourth and one situation. And the Bobcats are going to go. I guess they feel they have to. Over 14 minutes remaining in the fourth quarter.
Bobcats converting only 37% of their fourth down conversions this season. Not that good on fourth down. Here it's only with 1 yard to go, though.
The pitch is to Greer. He's got the first down and some room. He gets open down the sideline. He has Tom Menard to beat. And again, Menard is there to save a touchdown for the Hurons. What a game he has had. But credit Andrew Greer with a great, great run.
You see that a lot on fourth down. The defense is so anxious to get up there and get penetration and stop in the backfield for the loss to get the ball back for the offense. Sometimes they over-penetrate, and that opens it up for the big play as Greer bounced it outside. Picked up a huge gain. Call it 21 yards down to the 28-yard line where the Bobcats will have first down. We still have 14 minutes remaining in this game.
Well, credit Greer, who has not had a great day but has gotten some important yardage. With a nice run there, and the Bobcats now with a first down situation. The pitch is to Mobley. He tries to get outside and does. Works his way down to the 21-yard line. He's tackled there by number 5, Dan Bennett.
That's one of the first times that they've been able to get outside Menard. Menard just a step slow, pushing out Mobley down back by the line of scrimmage. Got around the end and was able to pick up 8 yards before Bennett knocked him out of bounds.
Well, the ball is spotted just shy of the 20-yard line. Second and 3 now. Such a critical drive here for the Bobcats. They have to keep this one alive. And if not, get in the end zone, at least come away with a field goal. Thornton gives to Greer. Greer with some room over right side.
Andrew Greer on the carry.
That is a first down for Ohio.
Tackle by Keith Bertram. First down, Bobcats.
That right side of Miles Davidson and J.D. Bradbury really fired off the ball that time and gave Andrew Greer enough room go for the first down.
You're talking about 284 pounds at guard and 295 at the other side.
Well, J.D. is a big one. Number 68, J.D. Bradbury, 295 pounds, 6'6". Thornton gives to Greer again. He'll again go to that
Andrew
strong
Greer
right side. Picks up a couple.
The Bobcats have shown on this drive they really don't have to do anything too fancy to move the ball against Eastern. They've stuck with their game plan. They've gone with their strengths, which is the running game. They've been able to move the ball. They just haven't had any miscues, any mistakes to stop them. They've been doing exactly what they've wanted to do this whole game, and that's move the ball down the field by running it, and that's what's brought them down here to the 12-yard line.
Well, the running game is their forte, and they've hung right with it. This is Mobley. No, it's a fake. I'll tell you, he had me faked out. Anthony Thornton fakes to Mobley, rolls out right, and gets the first down. I'll tell you, I was watching Chris Mobley, a heck of a fake there by the Bobcats.
Well, another guy that was watching him was Scott Jurek, the outside linebacker for the Hurons. He was running after Mobley. He had no idea that Thornton had the ball behind him.
Well, me and Scott Jurek, we were lost on that play, and Anthony Thornton takes advantage of Jurek's mistake and picks up the first down. First and goal to go. And we have a timeout called by the Hurons. That is the first for them here in the second half. So both teams with two remaining. 12:49 to go here in the fourth quarter.
Well, we mentioned the crowd earlier in the game. It might not be as big as the crowds we had for Parents Weekend and along for homecoming. on the 15th of October, but many of the fans have stayed here, as you see some of the Eastern cheerleaders trying to keep some of their faithful going, maybe the 100 or so that have made the trip all the way down here. But I do have a gut feeling, John, the Bobcats win this game tonight, it's going to be total bedlam on the campus of OU, and they might even just take over Court Street tonight.
You think so, Mark? Boy, I'll tell you.
No, of course, we're referring to Halloween weekend here in Athens.
You stick with Mark Lowry, you get a lot of insight here. I'll tell you, when we take a look at top that Mid-American Conference race, Ball State is up there at 5-1. They are playing out of league today as they'll take on Northern Illinois. Like I said, tomorrow night you'll know the scores from these games. But as I said before, Western Michigan hosting Central Michigan. So one of those teams obviously will lose today unless they end up in a tie, which is possible. However, as we're alluding to, the Bobcats with a real big opportunity here. So
the fans are standing up and cheering right now, John.
That's exactly right. And a critical drive, first and goal to go. Ball on the 5. Thornton gives to Mobley this time. Mobley with really nothing. Nice cutting outside. He might get in the end zone. Touchdown, Ohio University. And what more can you say? What an athletic run by Chris Mobley. Craig Peters, Mark, had him strung out. And as I said, Mobley had really nowhere to go but then turned on the afterburners and got outside and finds the end zone.
Well, it was a missed tackle by Brad Schmidt as Mobley bounced the ball outside. Peters, Mark dove and also missed him. And as we mentioned earlier, it seems like every time they need it, Chris Mobley is coming through with the 2 and 3 yard gains. And the Bobcats need him the most. That time he expands it out for the touchdown and really puts Ohio more than just back into this game, as the extra point attempt is good. So now we have a 17-14 game. And John, we still got 12 minutes, 41 seconds remaining in this fourth quarter.
A lot of football left. Now the way these two teams control the ball, that time will come off more quickly than it would with some teams, but still a lot of football left.
But also,
Mobley, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
It also sends a signal to the defense, let the defense know that yes, we can move the ball down the field when we need to, we can score when we really have to. And the Bobcat offense keeping its composure, moving the ball down the field. Now, if the defense can do the same and keep their cool and stop Eastern, Ohio's got a chance to take this lead or at least kick a field goal to tie it.
They certainly do. And as Mr. Stats, Dave Henke, points out again, Chris Mobley has been Mr. Clutch today, 8 carries for 37 yards. 4 of those carries have been for first downs. And of course, he just ran for the touchdown. So a great game turned in thus far by Chris.
Well, Mobley's been overshadowed a lot this year with the coming in of Dana Griffin along with Andrew Greer, both of course coming from junior colleges. And Mobley probably coming into the year felt he would get a lot more playing time than he has. But he hasn't seemed to be the kind of guy that would go stand at the end of the bench and mope about it. He's taking advantage of every opportunity he can. And as you mentioned, John, 4 first downs on carries along with a touchdown. That's coming through when you really need him the most.
Delverne sends this one high and shallow. The Bobcats drop number 33, Tim Kellogg, at the 23-yard line. Delverne has been sending his kicks high and shallow so the coverage can get down there. They've done a fine job. They drop Kellogg at the 23, and that's where the Hurons will set up shop. They still lead this one 17-14, 12:36 left to go in this football game. Nash and Foster are in the eye. Tom Sullivan wants to throw. He looks out to his right. He's got Ostrander. Pass is complete at the 37-yard line.
First down, Eastern. Pringle and Shy on the tackle.
And when Sullivan has completed passes today, it's been that type of pattern. Ostrander running a little out there for first down yardage. Bobcats need a big defensive series here. And this is Foster.
Bob Foster
brought down by David Terry, a gain of just 1.
Well, we mentioned it earlier, John, how the Bobcats lost last year 34-16 to Eastern Michigan. But it was 13 points in the fourth quarter that put the Bobcats away. Of course, the score being 21-16 going into the fourth. The Bobcats folded last year. This year, they're a different team. They're not. It looks like they're not going to fold. Instead, they come back with a touchdown to draw within three rather than giving up the 13 points like they did last year.
Well, the give is again to Foster. He hurdles a few Bobcats and gets out to about the 41-yard line. Terrence Davis in at linebacker makes the tackle. Davis, as we mentioned before, part of this young defense, just a sophomore, 6'2", 215 pounds.
You're seeing something here you really haven't seen over the last 3 years here at Bobcat football. The fans are going crazy. The players are waving, getting their arms going, trying to get the fans working together to try to stop Eastern Michigan. And it's a big third down conversion attempt here.
Third and five, Sullivan wants to throw. Looking deep, he's got no, and he finds his man, Foster. Foster came out of the backfield, makes the catch for the first down. He had no one open deep. Great coverage and good pursuit by the Bobcat defense, but Foster out of the backfield makes the grab for the first down.
I think you got to credit that completion a lot to Matt Klasse, the right defensive tackle there for Eastern Michigan, keeping Ed Shy, who's coming in, trying to pressure Sullivan away from him. Klasse, of course, the most improved player on the Eastern Michigan team over the spring.
And Sullivan did a good job of keeping his wits about him. It's now first and 10. They go back to the run. Foster over the left side. David Terry there again to meet him. It was Mark Mauersberger. My mistake. So Mauersberger brings Perry down after only a 2 yard gain. Second down and 8 now. And I'm not sure if they were drawn off, but the entire Bobcat defense crosses the ball line there, and that's going to be encroachment unless they were drawn.
Yeah, it's going to be offsides. They made contact. Instead of it being encroachment, it'll be offsides.
Well, Mark, I beg
I
to differ.
To reverse there.
I beg to differ, but the call is encroachment. Either way, it's going to go for 5 yards, and that'll bring up second down and 3. Mark smiling at me now as the handoff goes to Perry, or Foster, excuse me. Foster dropped for a loss. Tim Pringle was there coming out of his safety position to make the big play. That was Bob Foster on the run. He wanted to get outside, but Tim Pringle said no way. It drops him for a loss.
A multi-talented Tim Pringle. I talked to Coach Cleve Bryan early in the year about Tim Pringle. He said that he plays like between 5 and 7 musical instruments outside of playing football. Just a little fun fact on the side about Tim Pringle.
Well, this crowd coming to life again, as does the OU band. It's now 3rd and 8. Sullivan wants to throw again. He's getting pressured by Shy. Gets it to his back, Nash. Nash is dragged down from behind by Mark Mauersberger. Mauersberger and David Terry were there for the Bobcats. And that'll force Eastern to punt. A big defensive series turned in by the Bobcats.
Mauersberger, another junior college transfer for Ohio, comes in behind Jim Colosimo. Colosimo looks like they had the good screen set up. They had the lineman out in front of them, and it was only one Bobcat between the receiver and the end zone. But Mauersberger coming from behind to make the big stop for Ohio, and they're going to get the ball back here at 4th down and 9 with 8:24 remaining in the fourth quarter.
Well, Benitez to do the punting. Hargrove back deep for the Cats. This one's a nice one. Aspire Hargrove calling for a fair catch at the 20. Comes up and makes an adventure out of it. Kind of dive rolls across the 20, but hauls it in. The Bobcats will take over there. Well, with 8:13 left to go here in the ball game, the Cats hoping they can improve on their series advantage. They lead this series, actually, 8-4 since 1976, but I'm not sure any game has been quite as big as this one. This is certainly a big one as the Cats want to hold on to a first place tie for the Mid-American Conference lead. They trail now 17-14. Thornton on the keeper goes nowhere.
Dana Griffin on the carry.
Number 91, Brad Schmidt was there.
Peters mark on the tackle.
Well, the Bobcats move to the I formation now. It is Dana Griffin and Andrew Greer. Thornton looks like he wants to throw. Now he's going to keep it. He tucks it away and he fumbled. Well, I thought he fumbled. It sure looked like it, but I guess the officials don't think so. The Bobcats hang on. Thornton has fumbled three times today. He's hopped on one of them himself, but two have become turnovers. He's rushed for 136 yards, but Anthony better hang on to the football here. 7:06 left to go in the game. Third and 12 now for the Bobcats.
Fourth one would have been the most costly.
Well, the backs are split now. Ollie Perkins and Kyle Feldman are the receivers. And it's a draw play to Andrew Greer.
Andrew Greer, the ball
Greer doesn't
player.
Come anywhere near the first down as he's going to be about 8 yards shy, and that'll bring on the punting unit. So 6:40 left to go, still time, but Bobcats cutting it close here as they'll be forced to turn the ball back over to the Hurons.
The Bobcats not going to try to risk anything by passing. They're, as a team, eighth in the MAC in passing efficiency. Instead, they'll just run the draw and give Eastern the ball back, but we have a terrible punt.
I'll tell you what, that one may have gone for negative yardage, Mark. Graubacher got that one off the side of his foot. It goes out of bounds. I'm not sure exactly where the ball was spotted, but it's now at the 30-yard line.
Well, Ohio trying to just play conservative by running the draw if they get stopped and settle for the punt with plenty of time left. 6:24 remaining in the game. They punt it from the 23. Instead, it goes 7 yards to the 30. Eastern takes over. It's just as good as a turnover, in my opinion.
Basically. Now the Hurons definitely in striking range. Operating out of the eye. This is Foster, Bob Foster. He pushes it up for a 4 yard gain. That'll bring up second down and 6 yards to go.
Well, I think it'll be an emotional lift for Ohio if they can even hold the Hurons here to only a field goal. If they can keep them out of the end zone, that'll keep it within one touchdown to win it. And I'm sure Eastern Michigan, if it comes down to it, will be happy to just settle for the field goal to put them up by more than a field goal.
Yeah, certainly. This is a real test of the OU defense here. They've risen to the occasion a couple of times today. They'll need to do it again. This is, again, Bob Foster up the middle. Gets only 2 yards. Mark Mauersberger again there for the Bobcats. He has done a heck of a job here late in the ball game.
Third down again.
Well, we expected a good ball game, and we have gotten it. The third down conversions right now, EMU is 3 for 9 for the ball game, 4 for 4 as of late. Pardon me, that is 3 for 9 as of late. My mistake, they have one here. The pitch is to Foster. He didn't get it. He is stopped by number 34, Terrence Davis. Davis has had a couple of big tackles here late as well. So make that 3 for 10 now of late for Eastern.
This is decision time for the Eastern coaching staff. Do you kick the field goal of 39 yards and go up by 6? That way Ohio needs a touchdown to beat you. Or do you try to keep the ball and move it down and score and put this game out of reach? They're going to elect to go for it on fourth down. Ohio's defense yielding 66% on fourth down conversions.
Well, Jim Harkin was showing some confidence. It's Foster again, he hurdles. I don't think he got it. He had to go 2 yards to get the first down. He tried the old hurdle play, and he did not get it. The Bobcats stopped the Eastern Michigan Hurons with 4:24 left to go in the ball game. They'll take over on their own 21.
I know it's really easy to second guess right now, but I have to go against the Eastern coaching staff. He had a field goal attempt at the end of the first half. What was it, 52 yards? They came about a yard, yard and a half short. We're talking about a 38-yarder, which would have put your team up by 6, forced Ohio to move the ball all the way down the field, and score a touchdown with under 5 minutes remaining. Instead, you give the Bobcats the option here. A field goal is going to tie it, or a touchdown is going to win it.
Mark, I have to agree with you. Like you said, tough to second guess after the fact, but definitely I think a field goal would have been the better choice here. Nevertheless, the Bobcats take over. Thornton faking the pass, now on the run, stumbles, gets to the 25-yard line. Well, this is pretty much it now. 4 minutes to go in the ball game, and the Cats probably on their final drive of the contest unless something big should come up with, such as a turnover. This is very critical.
One thing that might come to the front pretty soon is Ohio used one of their timeouts and they had to settle down their defense earlier in the half. They only have two remaining, and with a running team and less than 4 minutes left and only two timeouts, that third timeout could be costly later on.
Good point, both teams with two remaining. Bobcats operating out of the eye now. Thornton looking to pass, runs to his left, fires deep. He's got Cross open, Cross can't hang on. Cross had beaten Charles Gordon deep. That pass may have led Cross just by a hair, but nevertheless, very catchable, and unfortunately, Byron couldn't come up with a big grab.
Talking about a difference of maybe 3 or 4 inches there. Cross giving it all he had, extending his body all the way out to try to come up with it. Thornton just let him just a little bit too much. Now the Bobcats are faced with another third down situation. Third and six from the 25. I think it's definitely four down territory right now.
Yeah, credit Coach Bryant with the gutsy call there going deep. It would have worked. He was open, but no go. Third and six, ball on the 25. Thornton looks like he wants to throw again. He's going to keep it. He's not going to come up with the first down. Thornton on the keeper up the middle.
Tackled by Nesson.
T. Nesson was there to stop Thornton, and the punting unit has come on for Ohio. The crowd not real receptive to it. Time ticking away with three. Now it's a fake, Mobley. He's got the first down and some more. He gets outside. Down to the 47-yard line, and Cleve Bryant pulls one out of his bag of tricks.
A big key to that is Ohio came right out. They didn't huddle back on the field again. They went right up to the line to punt the ball. Eastern didn't have time to set up a defense. They didn't know. I'm sure they were expecting maybe a fake from Ohio. But nevertheless, Eastern unprepared for that. The short snap with the Mobley. Once again, here we go. Chris Mobley, another first down, his fifth of the game, along with his touchdown. And he keeps Ohio in business out to the 48. A very gutsy call by Cleve Bryant.
Two in a row by Cleve, and it works as Mobley picks up the first down and some more. Now this is Thornton. He breaks loose for a big gainer. He's down to about the 43-yard line. That'll bring up second and about two.
I think one more piece of credit needs to go out to Andy Grumbacher. He had a bad punt last time to give Eastern the ball back, but did you notice how he jumped up with his hands over his head to pretend like the snap was long, maybe to draw the eye of Eastern for that split second while Mobley ran the ball around the end and picked up the first.
It was a beautiful play all the way around. The Cats operating out of the eye. Second two, this is Greer. He's got the first down and more. He's down over the 35 to the 33. Just 2:09 remaining now, and the Bobcats moving the football. I'll tell you, we expected a dandy. I'll say it again, we have gotten it. 2:09 remaining, Cats trail 17-14. But they're pushing the ball up the field. They have now gotten it into Eastern Michigan territory at the 34. First down and 10 to go. This is Greer again. Boy, I'll tell you, Andrew Greer really showing what he is made of. Picks up another big gainer.
A surging Scout Wyka on the 30-yard line just got enough of Greer to trip him up. If Wyka doesn't get his shoulder or his head down there by Greer's ankle, we're talking about a long run for a touchdown. But now Ohio forced to call a timeout, so they're down to one. Rather than regrouping and getting the snap off, they're going to take the timeout, not take any chances of a miscue here. And they'll gladly take the second and one here at the 26-yard line. I tell you, the Bobcats, mighty impressive so far on this drive.
Well, I'll tell you, this is a nail biter. Second and one. There you see the crowd there on the edge of their seats, someone flashing number one. In fact, the Cats are number one in the Mid-American Conference right now. They're trying to stay there.
Haven't been able to put that finger up for a while, but it feels good to do it.
It certainly does.
Final score, Duke 31, Georgia Tech 21.
Well, Mark, I guess the fact that comes up now is that the Bobcats have been plagued by turnovers all afternoon and even all season long, and they're moving the football with ease right now. They just have to hang on to it.
Well, the defense has really come through when they had to. They were a little over-anxious, a little over-aggressive in the early stages of the second half. They settled down. And by far, I think the two biggest plays of the game are the defense stopping Eastern on the fourth down and the fake punt with Chris Mobley running around left end.
Well, here we go, second down and one, the ball on the 25. Thornton looks like he wants to throw, but he's going to keep it. Now he pitches to Greer. Greer has nowhere to go, makes a nifty move, and cuts back inside the 25-yard line. Down to almost the 24, a nifty little move there by Andrew Greer.
Well, Andrew Greer had two choices. He could run the ball out of bounds and stop this clock, or he could cut it back up and go for the first down. What he's done is he's gotten the ball close enough to the first down where the officials are going to have to bring the chains out and check it, which stops the clock with 1:10 left. Now, what Ohio needs to do is they can't be sitting back watching for the measurement because they know they're going to go for it. You know, it's only third down. They're going to keep going anyway. What they should do right now is get in the huddle, call their play, get up to the line, because as soon as this measurement's over, the clock's going to start up again, and they could lose a precious 15, 10 seconds while they're still in the huddle. So what they're probably going to do, Thornton's trying to set up his team right now and get them back up to the line as soon as they can, so when the officials blow the whistle, they're ready to go.
And they are short by about an eyelash, and Thornton, as you said, doing just that, getting his troops together to go for this first down yardage. The Bobcats have now gone over 310 yards rushing today. So they've really rolled up the real estate on the ground.
And don't plan for Ohio here to get conservative maybe and just say, you know, let's not take a chance of a turnover and settle for the field goal. They're a team that people expected nothing from. They're in first place of their conference. For sure, they're going to be going all out trying to get this touchdown in the final 1:10.
Well, here we go. One of the biggest plays of the season here. Thornton pitches to Greer. Greer looking around the side. He's got the first down.
Andrew Greer.
Clock rolling now. Now it stops under, with the first down, it stops under a minute to go, 58 seconds. Greer continues to do it for the Bobcats, picking up critical first downs here late in the ball game.
Bobcats not losing any time on the spotting of the ball. They're ready to go as soon as the official set it down.
And this is Greer again up the middle. Doesn't get much this time, may have reached the 20-yard line.
We've harped on the fact all game that Ohio's a running team. They're eighth in the conference in passing. But you better start throwing the ball here, 38 seconds and ticking. Little confusion on the Bobcats side of the ball. They only have one timeout. Now we're down to 31 seconds.
They're taking their time about it too, under 30 seconds now. Thornton with a long signal count. He wants to throw. He throws incomplete. Byron Cross, the intended receiver, and I'll tell you, you have to question there. The Bobcats looked a little confused and let a lot of time get chewed up off that clock. It's now down to 22 seconds.
Well, if they just get the snap and throw the ball out, they save maybe a good two plays worth of time, meaning a good 10 seconds. When you're trying to stop the clock and trying to get out of bounds or throw incomplete passes, 10 seconds sometimes is good for around two plays. But instead, the Bobcats wasted precious time, about 12 seconds there after the spot of the ball to get that one off. The last play, they were ready to go. This play, they weren't at all. And with 22 seconds left, one timeout, Ohio has third down and seven now. The ball on the 20-yard line.
Well, what can you say? Sit back and enjoy. Well, now the Bobcats are going to take their last timeout. And Mark, I ask you, why let the clock tick all the way down and then take it? Confused, maybe?
Well, on the incomplete pass, they had the ball stopped. I mean, the clock stopped. Now the 25-second clock was ticking down. It wasn't even near expiring, which would have cost the Bobcats 5 yards and a penalty. Now, instead of having one timeout left where you had the luxury of throwing the ball over the middle if you want, maybe running a draw if you want, or doing just about anything because you know you have that timeout in your pocket to stop the clock if you need it, instead, Anthony Thornton maybe a little prematurely stops the clock and uses Ohio's last timeout. So that really puts the handcuffs on Cleve Bryan here. He really can't afford to throw the ball over the middle because with 22 seconds left, you don't know how much time you're going to have to regroup, you know, your team and get them back ready for another play.
Yeah, you want to at least get the field goal unit on here before time runs out. And you never know, like you say, you throw over the middle. You don't know, that clock might tick all the way down before you can do that.
Well, if it boils down to a fourth down and say five, I'll be very interested to see what Cleve Bryant does. I have a feeling he's going to go for the win either way. I don't know if savaging a tie, I don't know if he'll like that or not. Although there are three games remaining in the conference after today.
Well, here we go. Thornton back to pass. He's looking, finds nothing, he's rolling out. He's being pursued, he's got to get rid of it. He does now, throws it incomplete. And I'll tell you what, Brad Schmidt was pursuing Thornton, and this entire crowd was on their feet. Had he dropped him for a sack, it would have been at the 40-yard line, and a great pursuit by Schmidt and a good job by Thornton to finally get rid of it as he scrambled around.
Well, the Bobcats,
down to 11 seconds now.
Bobcats going to go for the tie. They make this, they'll be 3-1-1 in the conference. It'll be a 38-yard attempt.
Well, this is it, 38-yarder for Jim Delverne. Maybe the biggest field goal of his collegiate career thus far. It is up and it is good. So the Bobcats celebrate as they tie this one up at 17-all with just 7 seconds to go in the ball game. It's not over till it's over, but it's close to it, and the Bobcats have almost guaranteed themselves a tie now.
Well, it all goes back to Coach Arkema's call down on the 20-yard line when he decided not to kick the field goal and go for it on fourth down. Ohio held him, and as we said then, that could mean Ohio could come down here and kick the field goal to tie this game up rather than a field goal for Eastern, which would have put him up by six. And the old cliche goes, a tie's like kissing your sister, but Ohio, I'm sure, will kiss her sister tonight. They don't mind this at all.
No, they certainly don't, and for Eastern Michigan, really a critical game here because a tie doesn't put them out of the race, but it certainly makes things difficult as they came in at 3-2 in the Mid-American Conference. Well, what does Ohio want to do on the kickoff now?
I was just going to ask you the same thing. I'm not sure what they would do. I mean, if they're going to kick the tie and be happy with the tie, I'm sure they're going to kick the ball as far down as they can and be just, you know, get the coverage down and hope for a no big play on the final play of the game by Eastern. If you're going to go for the field goal instead of go for the win down there, I can't see you trying to do an outside kick and getting the ball back. You might as well have just, you know, if you're going to give them the ball on the 40-yard line, you might as well have gone for the win down at the other end.
Well, this is it. 7 seconds to go. 17-all. We'll see what the Cats decide to do with it. It's going to be high, kind of short. Ziegler is there. He's got it. Looks like he wants to pitch. Now he's going to take off. And he's brought down. The clock stops with 3 seconds left to go. Ziegler move up to the 25-yard line.
Well, the clock stops on a change of possession, but Eastern takes a timeout anyway. Gather up their brain trust and try to figure out something to do in these last 3 seconds.
Well, they've got one play, and you would have to assume they're just going to fire deep and hope for a defensive penalty.
Well, right now, I'm sure Ohio's coaches are telling their defensive backs, reminding them that if you're beat deep, tackle the guy. Take the penalty in college football. It's only a 15-yard penalty. We'll give him another play 15 yards down the field, unlike it is in the pro game where you can throw the ball up towards the end zone. There's an interference call. They get the ball down there. I'm sure Cleve Bryant will not mind at all giving up a 15-yard penalty if a receiver should happen to get behind the secondary rather than giving up the big play.
Yeah, and you'd have to think that Ohio will load that secondary up and expect the long play here.
Well, John, how do you feel about this tie?
Well, I'll tell you, it's been an exciting football game, and I certainly would have liked the win, but I think Ohio can be fairly happy with a tie. It certainly doesn't hurt their chances at a title. They moved to 3-1-1 now, but, you know, I don't know.
I agree, too. When you're playing the defending MAC champs, California Bowl champs, and you're surprising everybody with a 3-1 record in the MAC, you got to be happy with a tie here.
And this is it. Sullivan looking to throw. He's being flushed out of the pocket. He's going to fire deep. It's up and incomplete. Time has elapsed here at Peden Stadium. The final score, the Bobcats 17, the Eastern Michigan Huron 17. We're gonna wrap this up right now. We have just found out. We're gonna keep running. And Mark, your thoughts on this contest.
Well, I think Ohio showed signs of greatness and signs of mediocrity. They, throughout the second half, the defense played well when they had to, but they got a little impatient, a little over-aggressive. And that's what cost them the drive that was the field goal for Eastern Michigan and extended the lead to 10. They had a lot of opportunities. It seemed like they turned the ball over two or three times inside the Eastern territory when they could have had some good scoring threats. Of course, the long run by Anthony Thornton and then the fumble. And outside of that, I think if I had to look at this rationally, I think Ohio outplayed Eastern Michigan today. I really do. It's just the fact that they turned the ball over and Eastern took advantage of the turnovers, and that's what kept them in the lead and kept them in the game and got them the tie.
Well, Mark, I think you hit the nail on the head as you see the Ohio coaching staff moving off and the final score there, 17-17. The Bobcats certainly did look brilliant at times and may have outplayed the Hurons. A few mistakes cost them, but they still come up with a tie. They now move to 3-1-1 in the Mid-American Conference, rather, and Eastern Michigan goes to 3-2-1.
The Bobcats still, with a tie, control their own destiny. They win their next three games. That would mean Ball State, Western, and Central, no matter what they do against each other, would still have two losses in the conference. The Bobcats would have a loss in the tie. At first, earlier I questioned maybe they go for the win because they weren't expected to be here, but now I really understand what Coach Cleve Bryant did. He figures they still, with a loss, that really puts them in a hole. But now with the tie, that's all right. All they got to do is, you know, win their next three. And I hate to say all they got to do. Two of them are on the road. Of course, at Central Michigan next weekend. Ball State back here at Peden Stadium. And then to close out the season at Western Michigan. The Bobcats have to be happy with their performance today.
Yeah, the Bobcats, as you said, travel to Central Michigan next. The Chippewas were at Western Michigan today. So depending upon what they did, might be two first-place clubs going at it. And Eastern Michigan will see Toledo next. So they'll host Toledo. And as we said, the Bobcats move to 3-1-1. The Hurons are now 3-2-1. And that'll about do it. The final score here, Ohio 17, Eastern Michigan 17. For Mark Lowry, my name is John Lyons, and I'd like to thank our entire crew and our statistician, Dave Henke. You've been watching ABW Sports on ACTV, Cable Channel 7. Good afternoon.